holy, glorious, and undivided Trinity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in Christ you have revealed your glory among the nations. Preserve the works of your mercy, that your church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading is from the Lamentations of Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will sow the house of Israel and the house of Judah with the seed of humans and the seed of animals. And just as I have watched over them to pluck up and break down, to overthrow, destroy, and bring evil, so I will watch over them to build and to plant, says the Lord. In those days they shall no longer say, the parents have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. But I shall die for their own sins. The teeth of everyone who eats sour grapes shall be set on edge. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord.
Lord, for your words to my taste, A reading from the second letter to Timothy. As for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I solemnly urge you, proclaim the message, be persistent whether the time is favorable or unfavorable. Convince, rebuke, and encourage with the utmost patience in teaching. For the time is coming when people will not put up with sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own desires and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander away to myths. As for you, always be sober, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, carry out your ministry fully. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus told the disciples a parable about their need to pray always and not to lose heart. He said, "In a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor had respect for people. In that city there was a widow who kept coming to him and saying, 'Grant me justice against my opponent.' For a while he refused, but later he said to himself, 'Though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice, so that she may not wear me out by continually coming.' And the Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth?" The Gospel of the Lord.
Now it's on. Please be seated. So my name is Martin Dormish. I am a minister of Presence, Justice, and Memory at The Refuge, which is a faith community here in Broomfield. And we have just recently begun describing ourselves as a hub for healing community, social action, and creative collaboration. So I'm here collaborating today with my friend, Reverend Lyndon, and I'm very glad to be here with you. I'd like to begin my remarks this morning by offering an acknowledgement that the land upon which we sit and stand and worship today are the traditional homeland of the Hinanaedan, of the Tsitsitas and the Nuchi, better known to us as the Arapaho, the Cheyenne, and the Ute nations. Today's gospel passage calls on us to always pray and not give up. And to me, that begs an obvious question about what are we to pray for? What are we to not give up asking about? For what are we to pray and not give up? Is it for good health? This is something that's becoming more and more important to me as I get older and my body doesn't work as well as it used to. Is it for safety and provision for our loved ones? This is something that I feel very keenly because I'm a parent to 4 teenage drivers. Or is it for something like the Denver Broncos to find an offense? Because my memories go back to the Broncos' first Super Bowl in 1978, I can say that this is pretty much about as bad as it's been. But on a serious note, to answer the about what or for what question, are we to pray and not give up, I think it naturally results from today's gospel passage that it has a lot to do with the characters involved here in the parable that Jesus tells us. We have the widow, and this is a woman who represents a group of people in Jesus' day who are on the margins. They're often poor, they're often powerless. We have the judge, who Jesus tells us isn't a just one, but who is so annoyed by the widow and her persistent requests that he grants her what he and she both know to be justice. And then I believe justice itself is a possible and present reality, is almost another character in this story, because it certainly fits into the central context and narrative of the Gospel according to Luke as a whole. We're all familiar with Luke 4, in which Jesus shares his ministry and says why he came, to preach good news to the poor, recovery of sight to the blind, to free the oppressed. We have the Lord's Prayer, which has its own version in the Gospel according to Luke in chapter 11, in which Jesus teaches his disciples to pray to God, "Thy kingdom come." And this leads to a reality, this prayer, and to a world where the widow is considered, cared for, even prioritized, where the sick and blind and lame are healed, the hungry fed, when greed and abuse of power are denounced and decried and repented from. This is what I believe Jesus meant when he said, as recorded throughout the Gospel according to Luke, "The kingdom of God has come near." This is what I believe Jesus refers to when he asks, "And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth?" This is a faith in which Jesus followed, "Seek first his kingdom and his justice and his righteousness," and called his followers to do the same. I'm grateful that these questions are and have been made central to the life of this parish. My relationship to Holy Comforter goes back a little ways. I've had the privilege of working with Reverend Kim and Deacon Linda, and now Father Lyndon. And a lot of that has been through the Broomfield Faith Communities Together in Service Network, which is made up of a number of communities here in our area. And it was also my privilege to vote for the farmer's market to receive a very deserving recognition of a Heart of Broomfield Award this year. I've also had the privilege of attending on-site vigils here on Homeless Memorial Day the last two Decembers. My relationship to Broomfield also goes back a ways. In the late 70s and early 80s, I piled into my parents' white 66 Chevy Nova with my siblings from the drive from Southeast Denver, where I grew up, to Boulder, where my grandparents lived, on holidays and for family occasions. And to me, Broomfield at that point in my life was just a very, very remote exit on the highway to Boulder, and a place where maybe a lot of cows lived. It was a long, long drive, which is kind of funny now because we're so used to traveling long distances. I never thought I would live here and work here, but I'm grateful that I do. A lot of my work at the Refuge revolves around our weekday cafe, which serves as a day shelter for people on the margins. And it leads me to wrestle day in and day out with questions of justice for my neighbors in need, and questions about local realities from the past and present, and how they might be transformed in the future. One past reality that we often ignore is that this land upon which we sit and stand in worship today, as I mentioned earlier, from which much of our current individual and corporate wealth flows, and on which it depends, was originally occupied and settled illegally by U.S. pioneers. According to U.S. law, in particular the 1851 Treaty of Fort Laramie, Plains Indian nations agreed to allow safe passage for pioneers heading west, but none were supposed to or allowed to stay and settle here. Then there was this little thing called the Pikes Peak Gold Rush, that began in 1858. And we know the rest of the story. And that was even before Colorado became a U.S. territory. In terms of present realities, today's widows are single mom households, retirees living on severely fixed incomes, and families struggling to make ends meet, and individuals experiencing homelessness. It makes me wonder about the future. What kind of community will we be and become and pass on to our next generation? One of my big projects I've been working on the last few years was to research and write a report centered on Broomfield housing. It was published in the spring, and I'd like to read it in its entirety for you right now. No, I'm just kidding. I will distill its 252 pages into two stories for you and three statistics. So the first story is about a man named James. And he grew up in Broomfield and went to Broomfield High School and served in the military. And later on in his life, found himself in difficult circumstances and without a home. And he often stayed very close to here. The Arby's property and the dumpsters in that area are often where he slept. And then in 2019, late one night, right here on 287 and 10th Avenue, he was hit and struck by a car and killed while walking across the street. That story did not appear in any newspapers. So that's the story of James. I'd also like to tell you the story of Randy, which some of you may know. Randy was my friend, and he was a regular guest at the Refuge Cafe, which I help run. Great guy, also a Broomfield native, someone who grew up here, and someone who graduated from Broomfield High School and served in the military. And he too found himself in difficult circumstances after he had a marriage end, and from the fallout from that, he lost his job, his license to practice his profession, and he ended up on the street. And Randy, as some of you know, was part of this faith community and was treated very well by it, and he passed away on Holy Comforter property just a couple years ago. In terms of statistics, the first one I'd like to share with you is that the best estimate that we have from those of us who work directly with people who are experiencing homelessness is that there are around 200 people in Broomfield at any one time who are unhoused. And these include people in many different situations, but 200 people. Second statistic I'd like to share with you is 5,000. That is the number of households in Broomfield County who can be considered cost burdened. This is a technical term that the government uses to describe how much a household spends on housing. So the rule of thumb is that every household in the United States should only be spending 30% or less of their income on housing. Families and households who spend between 30% and 50% of their income on housing are considered moderately cost burdened or at risk of housing instability. I would imagine that includes some of us here in this room today. If a family or household spends more than 50% of their household income on housing, they're considered to be severely cost burdened. And that also means that they are at risk of homelessness. Our partners at Broomfield Fish, just in the year 2020, served almost one in five Broomfield households. These are distinct households, no duplicates, one in five. And of those households and families, they spend on average 70% of their income on housing. And the third statistic I'd like to share with you is 50 million. And that is the amount of money that I've calculated in partnership with others who are very close to the situation of what it would take to actually solve our housing instability crisis that we have here in Broomfield. So Jesus taught that we should always pray and not give up. And for what? I would say it's for God's justice to be done for the widow, the orphan, for people who are disabled and imprisoned, and those who are struggling to make ends meet. For me, that prompts a persistent prayer and request and challenge to my community to truly live up to the best of our hometown values by going beyond our chosen silos that tend to reserve those blessings for people who look like us and love like us, and apply those blessings to everyone. Not just residents who live next door to us or have similar incomes and social status. I've learned to pray that we move beyond piecemeal solutions to community challenges like affordable housing. Of a little here and a little there, a few actually affordable housing units here, a small batch over there, just so we can pat ourselves on the back that something is happening. I'm done with half measures, and I'm calling my community to consider full solutions. I'm learning to pray that we acknowledge the full extent of the challenge and the realities faced every day by our neighbors who experience the daily desperation of housing instability. Jesus taught his followers to always pray and not give up. And I think that applies to those of us who benefit from certain housing dynamics and property value increases, in that it obligates us to recognize that the flip side of those same dynamics cause others around us to suffer oppressive increases in cost of living and rent. I believe it obligates us to acknowledge that just as some of us enjoy the privilege of living in a community like this, and of stockpiling wealth in the form of skyrocketing home values, those things come with a sacred responsibility to use our wealth like the Good Samaritan, also known to us through the Gospel according to Luke, to truly choose to become a neighbor to those who bear the brunt of the shadowy effects of those increases. And that especially includes those left for dead on the side of our community's roads, in both the proverbial and literal senses. I believe we are to always pray and not give up by marshaling the will to consider our fellow citizens on the margins first and not last, by annually coming together to demonstrate the true heart of Broomfield by raising $50 million so that every Broomfielder has stable housing. I saw a quote on Twitter recently that you'll never be homeless in America if you're a car. There are 250 million cars in the United States and 2 billion parking spaces. And our nation now builds more three-car garages than one-bedroom apartments. There was a man in Broomfield who was unhoused, who was recently arrested. I don't know if you saw that story in the Enterprise, for barricading himself in a bank. I think we need to pray, in the words of Dr. Martin Luther King, for justice to roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream, for those who are oppressed, forgotten, left behind, despised, ignored. And that doesn't just mean out there generically in society or even in Broomfield as a whole, but in here at Holy Comforter, at City Hall, in our places of business, and in and through our individual lives. And that pinpoints perhaps the key question for us, I think, that is born out of this parable. Who are we most like in the story? The widow or the unjust judge? And what is our role in seeking God's justice and kingdom on earth as it is in heaven? And what is it we should be praying about and working toward in our own lives and faith communities and municipalities so that those things become realities right here and right now? Thank you.
Let us now, with confidence in the faith that we share in the God who is the God of justice, let us boldly state our confession and our trust through the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
Serve our neighbors and strengthen our community. We gather to offer our intentions, petitions, and thanksgivings to God.
I ask your prayers for the church, the inspiration and inheritance of our gifts of wealth, works, and wisdom. Pray for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Kim, our bishop, and all other ministers in the church. When we give out of our abundance, there is always more than enough. I ask your world, your greatest miracle. May we who walk this earth be wise stewards of creation and kind caretakers of all your creatures. I ask your prayers for those who lead our nations. May they use the plentiful resources they steward to care for the people of the world. When we give out of our abundance, there is always more than enough. I ask your prayers for our neighbors and all who need or request our prayers. For those who are marginalized and oppressed, those who are sick and those who are dying, for the lonely and isolated, for those who are suffering, and for those who sleep on our streets, I pray for all on our prayer list and family and friends we name now, either silently or aloud. When we give out of our abundance, there is more than enough. I ask your prayers for those who have died, especially may they forever gather at your table of plenty, sharing their gifts with love and joy. When we give out of our abundance, there is as the crowd gathered to hear Jesus preach, shared 2 fish and 5 loaves, They discovered that when their gifts were blessed, they increased and became a blessing to others. We give you thanks for the uncountable miracles and blessings in our lives, especially. When we give out of our abundance, there is always.
May we too reach within ourselves to share our gifts with the world so that our love overflows in a need-filled world. These and all things we ask in the name of your Son. Amen. Turning to page 360, page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right to glorify you, Holy One, and to give you thanks, for you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day, and beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing. Acclaim you, Holy God, glorious in power. Your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets you taught us to hope for salvation. Holy God, you love the world so much that in the fullness of time you sent your only Son to be our Savior, incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. Jesus lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners freedom, to the sorrowful joy. To fulfill your purpose, Jesus gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for Christ who died and rose for us, you sent the Holy Spirit, your own first gift of those who believe, to complete your work in the world and to bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for Jesus to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Almighty God, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and descent among the dead, proclaiming Christ's resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting Christ's coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us this bread and this cup. We praise you and we bless you. We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we pray to you, Lord our God. God, our Creator, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be the holy gifts of your holy people, the bread of life and cup of salvation, the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and apostolic church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. And grant that we may find our inheritance with all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through Jesus Christ, our Savior. through Christ and with Christ and in Christ. All honor and glory are yours, almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God, the holy things for the holy ones.
Thank you.
Our prayer after communion can be found on page 365, page 365 of the Red Books of Common Prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you forevermore. Amen. Please be seated. A very good morning to each and every one of you, those gathered here in the space of the church and those joining us in the digital spaces of Zoom. It is good to be gathered as God's people, and it is a real privilege and delight to welcome Marty Domage back to Holy Comforter, and thank you for your words this morning and the important and vital challenge, which I might add echoes something that our own Bishop Kim Lucas spoke of in her address just yesterday to the convention, reminding us of the importance always to keep in mind the imperative to love our neighbors, and not to use that as some sort of abstract way of avoiding people and choosing who our neighbors are, but to really take into the full account of that instruction and invitation from Jesus himself. I invite you to join us after the service in McGlaris Hall for coffee hour, and Marty will be talking a bit more about the report, the book. He'll be reading it. He'll be reading all of it then. So he promised to do so in the sermon, and I was just getting comfortable. I was having a drink of water and getting ready. Marty will be there. So what I'm going to invite us to do is to go in, grab coffee, grab something to eat, find yourself at a table, and we'll take a few minutes just for people to enjoy some fellowship, and then we'll have an invitation for Marty to talk about the history of the report, the writing and the report, and to enter into a time of conversation. So look forward to joining you all in McGlaris Hall following the service. As you know, our stewardship theme for this year is more than enough, more than enough. It reflects so much of the importance we have in joining our resources together, whatever kind of resources they be, whether, as we say in the prayers, it is works or wisdom or wealth, all in service to the good and common work of the gospel being expressed in word and deed through this community. So thank you for those who have already made a commitment, a pledge, as we participate and anticipate, I should say, 2023. And I invite you, if you haven't yet, to do so either through the cards that were sent out last month, or you can also do it online. Just click on the Give tab on the front page of our website. And as we've been doing, we've been reflecting upon that theme of more than enough through the stories of you, of us. And at this time, I'd like to invite Orville Wright to come up and to share his story of more than enough.
Good morning, Holy Comforter. Now that's a takeoff from the Armed Forces Radio Network in the late 60s, early 70s. Our journey to Holy Comforter began when Diane and I got married. Our hometown is Salida, Colorado. We're cradle Methodists. Born and raised up there, baptized and married in the First Methodist Church. After we got married, we moved several times. My first assignment was Wendover Air Force Base in Utah. The jackrabbits and coyotes carry canteens out there. Diane and I briefly stayed there. We spent the rest of my enlistment in Spokane, Washington. Then we moved back here to Colorado. And through several changes of location, we made it here to Broomfield. Through all this time, the United Methodist Church did not meet our spiritual needs. And as a result, we kind of took a back seat to organized religion for a number of years. What brought us to Holy Comforter was a funeral for Sally McReynolds, a longtime parishioner here. We attended the funeral, liked what we saw, and on the way home we discussed, we'd like to attend a regular service. Well, that happened, and we liked what we saw again. We filled out a contact card, and that afternoon Sue Carter called us. There was a welcome new members dinner being given here at McLaris Hall that evening. We attended that, and we were astounded at the reception that we received. And as a result, you folks have been stuck with us since September of 2012. We were confirmed the following April by Bishop Robb, and have thoroughly enjoyed the reception and the fellowship that we have enjoyed here. And over the years, COVID has caused all of us to change a little bit. The Holy Comforter has been affected the same way. As you can see, person-to-person attendance is starting to pick up, but there are still some problems that we need, manpower-wise, womanpower-wise. There are many things behind the scenes here at Holy Comforter that make it work for all of us. Talking about Altar Guild, Flower Guild, the choir, building maintenance, pastoral care, hospitality. All of these make it work for us. And some of us, some of them need your help. Specifically Altar Guild, the choir, building maintenance, all of it. But giving of your time, talent, and treasure, that's the key to it. Diane and I can attest to a new gathering that is taking place, the Grief Support Group. The time and talent of Judy Mathis, Wendy Banks, and the late Patty Davis have made that possible. And we can speak from personal experience that the support and what we learned at that altar, or that the grief support group, it gave Diane some closure, and it was a marvelous thing. Again, time and talent made it possible. You may figure that your time, talent, and treasure may not count, but ladies and gentlemen, everybody, there is no contribution that is too small. Remember, the bottom line to us is when we give out of our abundance, there is always more than enough. Thank you.
Thank you to Diane and Orville Wright for those thoughtful and invitational reflections for us. Just want to highlight a couple of other things coming up this week. Our Inquirers class continues on Wednesday with a simple dinner at 6:30 and the class beginning at 7. The topic for this coming week is formation. So look forward to joining you. Even if you haven't been to any of the other classes, please know that you are welcome to join us. Let me know so we know how to prepare for the dinner portion of that evening, but look forward to having you join us for an Inquirers class this Wednesday. We start in McLaris Hall. And on Thursday this week, from 9:30 to 10:30, our senior seminars continue with the topic on Medicare. So bring your questions and inquiries about changes happening to Medicare. Bring them on Thursday, beginning at 9:30 in McLaris. And finally, just a shout out to a couple of events coming up in our life together. The first is our annual Music for All Souls concert is on Friday, October 28th at 7 p.m. here in the church. More information in your bulletin. And the Sunday following, October 30th, we'll have our annual trunk or treat in the Market Square following the service as well. So opportunities as we move into that season, both that includes Halloween as well as All Saints and All Souls coming up. Again, more information in your bulletin. It is great to always, it's great to be gathered together with you as God's people. Please remember to join us in McGlaris Hall following our service today. But for now, let us stand and we'll sing our concluding hymn.
Hallelujah. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks.